We have another question, please. Back there.
I'm so glad I got the microphone because I'm from one of those border towns from Venezuela and Colombia. I'm actually Venezuelan. I'm from San Cristobal. It's on the border of Norte Santander in Colombia. So number one, I have to thank you because I believe that one of your greatest contributions as the two-term president of Colombia is to bring the hope back, not only to your amazing country, but to countries like mine, like Venezuela, that were in so much need of a future Alvaro Uribe in my country. So thank you for that. Enrique Capriles Radoski is the face of the young people like me that have hope for a new Venezuela, for some leadership like yours to come. Thank you so much for being here. My question refers to, there's so many successes and Colombia has received a facelift, you know, such a huge lift in so many aspects, social, economical, political, since you've been on board. How close is Colombia to being at stability socially, politically, and economically? And I hope my question is not too hard. Thank you.
Colombia, incredibly, Colombia, in the middle of violence, has been a very stable democracy. In the past century, Colombia had only 4-year interruption in its democratic path. I am very hopeful that Colombia, step by step, will be much more safer country deserving the trust of domestic and international investors, and country advancing in social cohesion. Therefore, it depends on every one of us to push. Remember, three policies we launch, and these policies work fine. These policies are the three policies I call the triangle of confidence: security with freedoms, democratic values. Second, investment confidence with social responsibility. And third, the validator, the end, social cohesion.
Thank you. Yes, another question, please, over here.
Presidente Uribe, buenas noches. Presidente Fox, buenas noches. A question to you is, today on the first page on the Wall Street Journal, it's announced that a number of Mexicans are going back to Mexico. There's more Mexicans going back today from the United States to Mexico than Mexicans coming into Mexico. And the article implies because of the economic conditions in the United States. Something the article doesn't say that I probably read, you know, in my case, I have lived here for 17 years and I'm thinking about going back to Mexico, is because of the triumph of the policies of Presidente Calderón. We're starting to see benefits. Contrary to what the papers say, things in Mexico are probably getting better. Maybe not in the north, but Mexico City, throughout the center, et cetera. So the question to you is, as we're thinking of going back to Mexico, investing, creating jobs, we have an election in Mexico. And fortunately for Colombians, when they had the choice to reelect you, you had the vision to continue the fight. In the case of Mexico, do you think that, I don't think that either of the three candidates is as committed as President Calderón to fighting. And in your case, Colombia had many, many democratic presidents, but they didn't get the job done. You had the values. So do you think that 6 years from today, regardless of who wins in Mexico, if any of the three candidates lack the passion to do what was right, as President Fox said, do you think Mexico will be better in 6 days if the leadership does not have your vision?
And the question is for which president or for both?
I know what President Fox is going to answer.
No, you don't.
No,
you don't.
For him to know, it is necessary that President Fox answers.
Let me make a comment here. I mentioned that electoral processes are a gift of democracy to us citizens. and a great opportunity to take decisions. I would think about three things that must happen. And right now, I'm in the middle of a conflict in Mexico because I've been expressing my thinking in trying to influence in the electoral process. Number one, we now have had 3 terms, 6-year terms of minority governments without having the capacity to change the big changes that Mexico needs. President Cedillo, President Fox, President Uribe, the three of us, we tried
Calderon.
We tried 3 reforms. Number 1, energy. Number 2, tax and fiscal. Number 3, labor. And we all three were not able to accomplish what we proposed. I don't wish the next government to go through the same situation. In a way, democracy is not delivering. So we must reach a point where either government comes strong out of an election and has the support of people to be able to move ahead. Alternative number 2, that we work on a coalition government so that we reach majority on government, like it happened in Brazil, where President Lula agrees with other parties so that he makes majority, and then he can move and have governability. Or number 3, like President Abraham Lincoln did, to invite his opponents to government. He invited his 3 opponents to the cabinet to govern with him. And the unity of the nation, of this great nation, came about. So it's time that after 18 years of failure policies, we move out and we reach consensus and we take decisions. Number 1. Number 2, we must get out of the trap where we are. Violence, crime, drugs is delaying the march of the nation. It's delaying the solutions of the problems of the nation. It's delaying the creation of jobs and wealth to people and families. And it's hurting the image of the nation. There must be a way out of this trap, and we have to find it, so that we come back to peace, like Colombia did. And that's also a key issue today on this election. And number 3, the 3 reforms, fiscal, energy, and labor. There is no future to Mexico if we don't solve these 3 key profound changes that we must do in Mexico. So to me, this election has to give us answer and support to these 3 things. Mexico can come back rapidly to growth, can come back rapidly to the leadership position that it had in the past just through that exercise. So to me, this is the great opportunity. And I'm over and above colors today. And I've been criticized severely in Mexico. I'm not red, I'm not blue, I'm not yellow. I love Mexico and I want a better Mexico for my sons and for my grandsons.
Presidente Uribe, algún comentario?
No, I have to respect all the ideas exposed by President Fox. Let me introduce only one very brief comment. In accordance with our own experience in Colombia, criminals, narcotraffickers are so pervasive that they have the capacity to destroy the rule of law. This is the outcome of many years of experience in Colombia. Therefore, to defeat criminals is fundamental for countries such as Colombia. Otherwise, Colombia cannot prosper. And of course, we receive cooperation from the United States, Plan Colombia. Plan Colombia this year is worth less than $350 million. But the Colombian budget for security is over $10 billion. Plan Colombia is much more important, politically speaking, than economically. But Plan Colombia alone is not effective. I remember that when we arrived to the presidency, Plan Colombia had been in place for 2 years, and it had been ineffectual. What was the reason? We need domestic political determination. We need much more budget. We need much more police. We need much more international cooperation. But we need internal domestic political determination. Otherwise, we are going to lose.
Thank you very much. Another question. Yes, who has the microphone? Please. I see two microphones. Okay. Yeah. One microphone.
This is for Mr. Alvarez. My question to you is, what do you see for the future of South America or Venezuela, for the future Latinos or Latin Americans, and why do they cover the media that happens over there that goes on under wraps?
Thank you. Mr. Uribe?
Maybe I am quite radical, but the only right path I foresee for Venezuela is that the democratic opposition wins the October presidential elections. This is the only path I foresee for Venezuela at this moment. I am fearful with the only aspect of thinking any continuity of the current regime. Democratic values are the only light I anticipate for Venezuela.
President Uribe, I'm Colombian. I'm from Medellin, which is your hometown. And there's a saying I really like that says, a man or a woman is not from the land where it was born, but rather from the land where he or she grew up. And I was born and I grew up in Medellin. Unfortunately, many years ago, before you were president, I had to flee for security reasons. And I was very painfully away from where I was born and grew up for many, many years. I wanted to thank you tonight because of your hard work and your leadership. You have allowed my son, Samuel, and my daughter, Valentina, to be Colombians, even though they were born here in the U.S. Thank you for that, President, because of you, they can go back with us and they can feel they're Colombian and do their roots. And I want to thank you for that. And I had two quick questions. What are the three, and this is not has nothing to do with politics, so hopefully it's not too big of a change, but what are the three main traits for you of a leader? And what are the two or three leaders, worldwide leaders, that you most admired and inspired you?
What is the first question?
What are the three features, what are the three key things that a leader must possess to be a great leader from your perspective? And what are two or three leaders that you have admired and have inspired you? Thank you.
Maybe I will mention four elements for leadership. Three that I have read from my professor, John Coulter. Honesty, energy, and competence. Then you need a combination of the three. Because thinking one individual, he's honest, he's competent, but he has no energy. What is the result? He has not the engine to get things done. Other combination, the individual The leader is honest. He has energy, but he's not competent. He does not know where to go. And the most dangerous combination. He has energy, he's competent, but he is not honest. What an explosive car bomb. I will add one last element, my friend. Love. When you fulfill your assignments with love is the driving force to make you accomplish your tasks with integrity, with dedication, with devotion. Love is the source of the best values.
Second. Let me expand a little bit. My thinking is that we are all leaders, that we're leaders all the time of our life, but unfortunately, many of us don't go within ourselves. We don't learn who am I, what am I in this life for, and what is my purpose. And purpose is a very meaningful, powerful word. It applies to any human activity. Must have purpose. And the higher, the better, the best structure, purpose is really what makes leadership. Leadership is within. Of course, it's composed by knowledge. But how many leaders that don't have knowledge exercise a very strong, successful, powerful leadership? So to me, what we have to do is discover that power we all have within, to learn that we can go much higher than what we can think about or envision. And once we try ourselves, once we move ahead, then we start like floating and growing and accomplishing great things that we never dreamed about. So you just have to let loose your energy, your power within, and make sure that you have a good cause, the best of causes. There's nothing better as a cause than being for others and doing things for others. Mm-hmm. So, gracias.
And I think you wanted also them to mention who were the leaders that they respected. Yes, President Uribe, would you start?
I would recommend you a book if by chance you have not read this book. It is a biography of Bolivar, our liberator, written by John Lynch, the British writer. I recommend this book because it portrays a very positive leadership of Bolivar, all the opposite that President Chavez sings about Bolivar. In Colombia, to create confidence in our people, it was very important during our two terms, to live in permanent contact with communities, to fight the war in the streets. This was one main principle of President Lincoln, to live in close contact with communities. I have been asking many universities, what was the outcome of 8 years of close, of tight communitarian meetings in your country? My answer has been this. At the very beginning, people came to our Saturday communitarian meetings with complaints, with claims, and with anger. At the very end, people continue coming with their complaints, with their claims. The country was not in a paradise, but with hope. This close contact with our people created confidence. it was the right path for the vast majority of Colombians to pass from anger to hope.
President Fox, who are the leaders you respect?
I was thinking about it, and no doubt I go for those who have changed the world through their own word, through their love and their compassion, like Martin Luther King, like Lev Walesa, like Nelson Mandela, like Mahatma Gandhi. Great accomplishers, great moral strength. But then you read Steve Jobs, the Einstein of the 20th and the 21st century. 10 years smoking marijuana, 10 years using LSD, and he comes to do maybe the greatest of accomplishments in today's world. The largest valued company in the world, Apple, the greatest products that changed the world, and his behavior was not really a humble one, was not really a loving one, and still he did great things. So it's pretty difficult to define what leadership is all about. We just have to let ourselves free. We just have to let the horse run. We just have to let our beliefs, our convictions grow and expand.
Thank you very much. Another question, please. Over here.
That's it. Yeah,
tell me, bro.
My name is Juan Borda. I am the president of the Colombian Association. It's an honor to have Mr. Uribe here. Basically, we want to say thank you. A big thank you because you changed our country. 10 years ago, we were down. Now we are up. Thank you. Basically, we have two questions. I want to be brief. The first question is, you talk about social cohesion, private investment. How can we, the Colombian community in the United States, out of the country, help bring those goals of cohesion, social cohesion, private investment, make that goal a reality using the bridges that the government and the Colombian community out of the country can have? How can we join those forces?
Very, 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 very short answer. You could think with entrepreneurial spirit. You should have private endeavors here in the United States and in Colombia to push Colombians for becoming much more job creators than job seekers. If I would say one single answer to you, I say this: create high quality jobs in Colombia. Please influence, exercise influence in your people for them from here to have private initiatives in Colombia to give people possibilities of formal economic jobs.
Thank you, Mr. President. You are talking about creating private jobs. Here, let me introduce Claudia Mirza. He owns a big company in Dallas-Fort Worth. She also creates some jobs in Colombia overseas. And she has a question for you.
Thank you. Mr. President, I cannot tell you are my hero. And I am very pleased to say that I want to show my children the history books about all the history that you made in Colombia. We love you. And the, the question that I had for you, and I just let me leave you, give you a little bit of background. I remember being an 11-year-old walking in the streets of Medellin whenever Escobar was bombing the city, and the nuns used to tell me, you need to leave the city, you need to leave the school right now because there are threats that we are going to be bombed. Those images are in my mind. I have not stopped working since I left the city, and I came here to this country. I created jobs. I have not stopped working. I am a prime government vendor for the United States. We are doing great business, employing mothers, employing people from the military. And we are here trying to help the Colombians become more entrepreneurial and also trying to assess through several corporations. But my question to you, and all of them are coming to us, is how can we help Colombia through the TLC, to the Treaty of Free Trade, or Free Trade Agreement? Just give us some strategic highlights about what can we do to help as entrepreneurs.
I will begin with the last question. My view is that given the current economic situation in the world, we should not have high expectations about the increase in bilateral trade between Colombia and the United States, at least during the first years of the agreement. What we could expect is that the free trade agreement gives Colombia a hint before the international community of a country in which you can trust. In my opinion, the free trade agreement is very important for domestic and international investors to see in the free trade agreement a clear signal to invest in Colombia. In Latin America, governments have thought in three macroeconomic tools, indicators: jobs, inflation, and growth. In my opinion, the most important is investment. If I were an international investor or a Colombian living outside the country, I would say to myself, this is the right time for me to invest in Colombia. If the United States has ratified the free trade agreement with Colombia, it's because we can trust in Colombia, promote investors in Colombia. I am not a hero. 50% of my fellow Colombians have suffered a lot because of this violence. You have told us your own experience. You are a hero, as my fellow Colombians living here are, or either in the country. If you were not a hero, you were not with the idea of loving Colombia. Because of the bad moments you live in Colombia, maybe you should have hated my country, but you love the country. Whoever loves her country, after having lived so difficult moments, are the moments you live in Colombia, is because she is a hero. You are a hero.
Thank you very much. I would like to give President Fox the last word, but before I do that, we like to have little surprises here. I have a surprise from Washington, D.C. Our Congresswoman Kay Granger, would you please say hello to everybody?
Hello, I'm so glad to be able to talk to you. I wish that I could be talking with you in person, but I have returned to Washington.
Well, thank you so much. We couldn't have made this presidential series, ma'am, if you had not been with us. We love you dearly. Everybody say, we love you, Kay. And now President Fox is going to be speaking to you and to all of us. Thank you, Congresswoman.
Thank you very much.
President Fox.
Adios.
Adios.
Well, I guess it's a good time now to end up this great dialogue. And thank you again, President Uribe. We will be meeting ourselves on the road, working together with our foundations. Today, fortunately, we find Latin American leaders, former presidents, former prime ministers on the road, working to build a better world. Most of us have our foundations, and all this we learn from leadership here. We see former presidents so active in this nation, contributing so much to that better world, that now we're following that example. God bless you. I'm going to end up with a prayer that we didn't have from Juan before we had dinner. And it's not really a prayer. It's something I read from Deepra Chopra. We should gift ourselves every day with 5 minutes in silence to go within and make some reflections, evaluate. Am I happy with what I'm doing? Am I doing enough for others or for my family or my nation? Should I correct part of what I'm not doing right? And after those 5 minutes, he says, we have 24 hours a day to make our commitments come true and to make things happen. I think this is the great gift to have so many hours to do what we must do. To commence again is the opportunity we have, all human beings, every day. To commence new challenges, to commence new dreams, to commence new actions. And that's what we have as in the spirit in these gatherings, that we can commence again, that we can build again, that we can bring joy to our lives through doing that. So again, God bless you. We'll see you after summer, but before that, please come to Central Fox on May 31st. Gracias.